gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, you know what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon's Water and Hole Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
All right. Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Salvation Saloon. And today, some of you are aware of this, but we do have something special for you guys today. The Nitty Gritty Church Band is among the missing, but that's okay. We got our good friend, Jace Harold, and he is here to do our worship. Here's Jace. Worship God, guys.
Just build my mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angel I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me. It's all my mansion. It's near God's throne. I have no castle, no earthly kingdom, but my cabin will do till I get home. It doesn't matter who lives around me. Yes, oh, it's near God's throne. Just build my mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angel I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me. Just so it's near God's throne. My mother's mansion may be close to me, across the Golden Avenue. She was the first one to tell me of heaven, and the very to tell me of you. Just build my mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angel I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me. Yes, so it's near God's throne. Just so my mansion, it's near God's throne.
Well, good morning. My voice is clearing up there a little bit. It is good to be back here again. Love you guys. It's been a few years, and my heart always goes out to you guys. I know you got a big mission over here, and you've been a big blessing to my life. So thank you for that, and I'm trying to be a blessing to you this morning. I'm not quite sure, and every time I hear that intro, it's so good, but it don't sound anything like what I what I sing. Now, you probably would be surprised. I grew up north, and I grew up rocking. I tell you what, the first 30 years of my life, I did a lot of. But then I got saved. I'm just kidding. I'm trying to be a comedian, okay? Sorry. I'm trying. I know you all know this one. You're going to have to help me sing this one, okay? You going to do that for me? Some land morning when the clock's old, I fly away to a land joy's never end. God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to live and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. Empty grave was there to prove my Savior lived. Because He I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone, because I know He holds a future. Life is worth living just because He lives. I got ADHD, so I can't sing a song too long. I gotta keep moving on. I got this thing that the Lord's been putting on my heart lately. I'm one of those guys that overcomplicates everything. I'm perfectionist, whatever you want to call me. And so when I pray to Him, I always think it's got to be some really thought out. I got to ask for big stuff. Oh, don't worry, I got the small stuff. And lately, the Lord's been just telling me, "Hey, I can deal with the small stuff too." And I'm like, and some of the small stuff is actually pretty big. I've been praying for the, because I know as humans we want stuff because we want to be happy. Well, why don't we just pray for happiness and forget about the stuff? Amen. You know what I'm talking about? Amen. We dream about doing stuff, we buying things that's gonna make us happy, and I want to bypass all that. I just want to get to the happy part. So I've been praying for joy. The Bible talks a lot about joy, and it is a powerful thing to have, and it is what speaks to the nations. It does. If you want to change this world, have some joy. It's addictive. So I'm going to sing this whole Sunday school thing with you. This you ought to know. I got the joy down in my heart, down in my heart, down in my heart. Joy, down in my heart, down in my heart to say that I'm so happy, so very happy. I have Jesus in my heart. I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. That's it for that one. We can't have too much joy. Paul said, do 3 songs. I've already done 10. So, I got this old hymn that this is my very, very favorite hymn right now. I don't know why. I like to do the more of the honky-tonk gospels, what I do. I'm the only artist in the whole entire world that does that, or admits it anyway. This is my favorite. Every time I do a deed I shouldn't do, every time I say a word I shouldn't say, let me tell you what I do if it brings a blessing to. I just eat away somewhere and pray. I just eat away, I just eat away, and I ask my blessed Lord to lead the way. I just eat away, I just eat away, I just eat away somewhere and pray. I know God will heal, answer all my prayers, if I thank Him for my blessings every day. When I'm burdened down with grief, He will give my heart if I steal away to Him and pray. I just steal away, I just steal away, and I ask my blessed Lord to lead the way. I just steal away, I just steal away, I just steal away somewhere and pray. I just steal away somewhere and pray. Steal away and pray. I'll tell you what, that's what we got to do. There's nothing better than to get up in the morning, get in your alone time, and just sit there and hang out with the maker of all the universe and everything else. How about that? He hangs out with us in the morning, listens to our cries. I just figure it's a lot easier just to talk about praises than it is about whining. I'm trying to stop being a whiner. It's a hard addiction to stop. Amen? I don't even want to ask for blessings. I just want to be thankful. Lord, just help me be thankful for what you do. He's so good. Amen. He's so good. Well, I got one here. I'm going to do one of my own songs. Is that all right? And I think this one fits because we're a bunch of knuckleheads here. So, it's my way or the highway's what my daddy said to me. But I left home the hard way, cause I just couldn't see. My rebel ways took me for days down some old dead end road. But that all changed when Jesus came to control and saved my soul. Now that His way is my way, I don't waste my time trying to make it on my own. Now that His way is my way, the steps I take, for heaven's sake, I'll never walk alone. I don't wake up every morning with my halo on, cause my stubborn pride ain't satisfied leaving me alone. So I drop down on my knees and give my keys up to the one who's my designated driver, and He always takes me home. Now that His way is my
my time, try to make it on my own. Now that his way is my way, the steps I take, for heaven's sake, I'll never walk alone. Steps I take, for heaven's sake, I never walk alone.
True story.
Yeah, well, I love that guy right there. We've known each other for a few years and been able to not only utilize him to worship here, but on one of our Bronson projects, we were up in the Gainesville area, and, man, we made a week of it, and, man, what a blessing, and one of my most favorite people on earth right there, Jace Harold. So, all right, well, welcome, everyone. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. We like to start our services out by letting our first-timers, if there happens to be any here, we like to start by just letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. We truly believe God's going to bless you guys today. There is one thing we would ask of you, though, if you don't mind, and that is if you just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place, and if you would, just throw your name in that, tell us where you're from, that'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you just hold on to this card till the end of the service and right down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. But again, we just want to make sure you guys feel welcome, and from here on out, well, you are our guest, so sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride. Now, everyone else knows we do have some other purposes for these cards, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, or it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, well, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason for these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen, people? Bible tells us this. Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family, and like every family, well, we try to make sure that we recognize each other, and by gory, I believe we got us a couple of saloon-tick birthdays. Hey! Come on!
Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday! Happy birthday! Happy birthday to you!
All right, happy birthday. And there is a game we play each and every week, and it is called Name That Saloonatic. Now, if you happen to be here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics. And every week, what we try to do is we try to get an old picture, we throw it up there, and then we try to guess who it is. Well, see what you can do with this. See if you can tell me who this Saloonatic is. Who is that lady? The lady, the mother. Yusuf has nothing. Brenda?
Dave George.
Dave George, of course. Peggy? Who said Peggy? Well, let's find out. Will the real Saloonatic please stand up? And it is. It's Peggy. All right. Very good. I thought we were gonna stump them there, Peg, for a while. All right. Moving right along, I do have a couple quick announcements to pass on to you guys. We're planning a men's fellowship dinner, and that's going to take place on Friday, July 30th. So that's not this coming Friday, but the following Friday. Men's fellowship dinner, Friday, July 30th at 7 p.m., and that's going to be taking place at Ford's Garage. Next week, I'm just kind of throwing this out to you guys so you have it in your memory. But next week, we'll actually have a sign-up list so we can get an idea of how many seats we need to reserve. But just throwing that out, that Friday the 30th, we're going to have a men's fellowship dinner. Also, and I don't know what's left there, but if you notice on your way out, if by any chance you happen to ride a motorcycle or have an interest in motorcycles, I was given a mess of Wheels of Grace magazines to pass out. There's an opportunity to grab a subscription in it also. Real neat magazine. It's a motorcycle magazine for Christian riders. Lot of great information. Anyways, there's some free copies there in the back. If you'd like to have one, you can. Anyone want to claim this one, you can run up here real quick and do this because I'm not really sure what's back there, but there you go, feller. So that's that. All right. Well, we need to get going here, and we obviously need to start our service off right. And so right now, let's get Pastor Bill up here, and he's going to pray God's blessing on the remainder of our service.
Do I look like a Western movie star? No. Look like a fat kid from New York, praise God. Right? Like if they had something like, he liked cake or something, that'd be a good song, right? So listen, welcome to the Salvation Saloon. We're so happy that you're here. For those of you that are watching at home, we hope you're enjoying yourselves. Come see us in person because you're missing out. Because you should see what I'm looking at. Woo! This ain't no ordinary church, I'll tell you that. So we're so excited about what God's going to do today, and we've got a great message for you, so hopefully you'll still like us at the end. But let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we could be in your house this morning, God. We just love this family you created. Lord, we just love you, and we thank you for every good thing that we have in our lives. Lord, we thank you that we can gather and just enjoy ourselves and listen to the beautiful gift that Jace is to us. God, what a talent he has and a beautiful voice you've given him, and we just thank you so much he could be with us this morning. Father, we ask that you bless the gift and the giver, that you would multiply it, that it would meet the needs of the church and advance your kingdom. And Father, we just love you. We love you and love you. So we thank you for every good thing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, Lord, my God, I am awesome wonder, consider all the world's hands of me. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displays, and sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. when Christ shall come, shouts of adoration, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. And I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim how great my God is. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
I think we could lose this one. Jason's just trying to say he's a little taller than I am. Good God. What happens when you start smoking at 7? Y'all think I'm kidding? All right. Well, hey, welcome to the Salvation Saloon once again. Just so you know that there are CDs available, right, that you brought with you. You can purchase Jason's stuff. It's going to be at the back table on the way out. So be sure to avail yourself of that awesome stuff, and it sounds really good in the car. And if you're alone, you can sing along, and nobody will cry. Check one. Hello. Got me? It keeps swinging away. Why is it so loose? Where's Dave? Dave. Is he watching? Is Dave watching? All right. Awesome. So listen, here's what we're going to do this morning, okay? This is something that God put on my heart because of a conversation I had with Suzanne and some others. And we were just talking about the difference that God makes in our lives and why sometimes we don't share that with the folks God puts in our lives. And the consequences of that decision that we make unintentionally has lasting effects, unfortunately, for some. So what I'm going to do is we're going to go through this quick. I'm going to read through the whole thing, and then we're going to go back and unpack it, okay? So here we go. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linens and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores, longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and he saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things, but now he's comforted here and you are in agony. Besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been set in place so that those who want to go forth here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." He answered, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have 5 brothers. Let him warn them so that they will know they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone from the dead rises from the dead." So that's a nice story, huh? Thanks for coming. It's one of the parables, and Jesus always likes to teach in parables. That's the way he did it in those times. So this crowd that he's speaking to, dispersed throughout the crowd, is who? The Pharisees, who already can't stand him. They've already had enough of Jesus' crap, because Jesus doesn't pull any punches with them. He just got done talking about how God rejoices when we save things, right? The lost sheep, lost coin. He talked about the evil of money, the love of money, how it's evil. And then he's showing us here what happens to somebody who does not do what they're supposed to do, right? A rich man. So here's the story, right? There was a rich man who dressed in purple and fine linen, and he lived in luxury every day. And our next verse is, at his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores. Now, Lazarus means, his name literally means the one God helps. And it's unusual, in fact, in a parable to see a name. Jesus always would say the rich man or the woman. But to give somebody a name, a specific name, is important in this story. It's the one God helps. And we'll see what happens and the difference in their lives. So here's Lazarus at this man's gate. This rich man, every time he goes in and out, sees Lazarus. He sees him there, right? And he's laying there with the dogs, just longing to have something that fell from this guy's table, right? Says the scraps from his table. Roll with me, Mike. Longing to eat. So he's there, and he watches what goes on. He sees the other fancy people in their fancy clothes go in and out. And he can smell the food that's being cooked and all the fancy stuff that's going on. And he's out there with nothing and nobody. And he's even tormented by the dogs. Not a great life, right? The time came when he died, and the angels brought him to Abraham's side. And the rich man also died, and he was buried. Now, when Lazarus died, we don't know what happened to him. He had no money. He had no people. He had nothing. What happened to his body? Was it thrown into the garbage dump? On a dung heap? We don't know. But the rich guy, I bet you he had a nice funeral. All his friends in their fancy clothes and showed up and made a big production out of it. What a great guy he was, because he had all this stuff. But where does he end up? In Hades. He's in torment. He looks up, he sees Abraham far away, and Lazarus is there by his side. And he realizes, hey, what's going on here? But he still doesn't get it right in his head, because look what he says next. He calls, Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. He still thinks Lazarus is beneath him. He's in hell. Lazarus is in heaven with Abraham, and he still thinks that Lazarus is a servant to be sent on missions for him. Send Lazarus. Could you imagine the nerve of this dude, right? He's like, when is he going to get it? Apparently never. Never is he going to get it. Because he still thinks that even though he's by Abraham's side, he's beneath him. And what does Abraham tell him? Son, remember that in your lifetime, you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. But now he's comforted here and you're in agony. Basically, he's telling him it's your own fault. You got what you deserved. You are where you're supposed to be based on the way that you lived and the way that you treated this man. Next. Besides all this, between us is a great chasm that has been set in place so that those who want to go from here can't, nor can anyone from there come here. It's too late for you. Too late. You're where you deserve to be. Brought it on yourself. Next, please. He answered, then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family. So he shows here that he's got maybe a little bit of heart because he loves his family and he wants to warn his five brothers. But once again, he still wants to send Lazarus like he's a servant. He's still not getting it. He said to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they're done for. Because if they don't listen to them, nothing that we do, if we send somebody, they won't hear it. just like you didn't hear it. You had Moses and the prophets, and you didn't hear it. You walked past this man every day, and you knew what the law taught, that we were to do good for the poor. We were to take care of the poor. You knew that, and you chose not to. And now look where you are. See, there's a lot of us in the church that are saved, right? And thank God for that. You know, I met Jesus Christ in solitary confinement. He came to that filthy place and he changed my life and he changed my future. But with that, I got a responsibility to share that with other people, the people that I care about, because I don't want them to end up where he is. I don't want that for them. I got saved, and saved people serve people, right? We want to get someone else and spread that news and let them know, hey, you don't have to end up there either. There's a way out for you too. And it's more important than anything else we could ever tell them. We'll send people pictures of what we had for lunch, but we won't share Jesus Christ. What are we doing? What are we doing? We have a member of our family that had a heart attack yesterday. Right? How many people have we buried this year? It's up to us. The plan of salvation includes us. Jesus did his thing. He's done. That's why we call it the finished work of the cross. His responsibility is over. It's on us now. So when we say, I love my mom, I love my sister, I love my cousins, but I don't tell them about the good news message of Jesus Christ, do I really love them? Am I being honest? And I'm not saying you have to be Billy Graham, right? None of us are. But we're Christians and we have a responsibility for the people that we love. We're responsible to try and tell everybody that comes into our path that, hey, listen, man, this world is nuts. And everything that you're trying will not lead to happiness. Trust me, I tried it all. I never met a drug I didn't like. Right? There is nothing, nothing, nothing in this world that will give you peace like Jesus Christ. Amen. There's nothing that will give you a future like the risen Son of God. And that's what we are called to share with people. There's no greater gift. And when you get to do that and you see somebody accept the Lord truly who he is and what he came to do, so that you know that if they drop dead an hour from now, they're going to heaven and you're going to see them again. When you get to play a small part in that, it's huge. There's no better high than that, I promise you. I've had them all. We as Christians, Christian itself means follower of Christ. We call ourselves Christians, but we act like we're not. We leave here and we forget. Some of us, if I went to your job and I asked all your coworkers if you were a Christian, would they know? I'm not gonna. But would they say yes? Oh, yeah. They say, oh, I didn't know. How could they not know? We're called to be different, right? We are called to be in this world, but not of this world. We are to be concerned about the things of God and the people in our lives if we truly, truly love them. Now listen, if you're grumpy like Mike and old and you don't love anybody, that's okay. No! All right, guess you're off the hook, praise God. But for the rest of us that have heart and love people, right? It's on us to tell them the truth. And listen, we love you guys and we love your families and we know that you mean to do well. But we were talking about this that so many times we say it 1,000 different ways and sometimes people don't get it. So that's why they call me in. Because I'm the hammer, right? I'm the guy that will beat you over the head in love, but I'm not going to pull any punches. Because someday I'm going to have to stand before that same God and I'm going to have to answer for what I told you. Not just what I did in my life, but what I did in your life. And I want to be able to say that I didn't pull any punches and I told you the truth. And the truth is that if we don't share Christ with our family, if we don't let them know what he did for us and what he did for them, that's not a great spot. Now, what they do with that knowledge is on them. We're not responsible for that, right? I am not responsible for the outcome. I'm only responsible for the effort. And I promise you, if you pray up and you pray for that person before you talk to them, God will give you the words. And if you can't do it, drag them in here. I'll do it. Amen. We'll all do it. We'll lock them in here till they accept Christ. Sick grizzly on them, right? Because we love them. We love them, and we love you. Everything we do is out of love. But we want to see us get past these things, right? Sometimes we get stuck on stuff that should have been done in Christianity 101. Our first year saved, right? Some people have been walking with the Lord for 10 years, walking really slow. Come on, man. Let's get on with it. Let's do what God's called us to do so that we can move on to bigger and better things. You know, sometimes with God, you don't get to flip assignments. You know, until you're done with that, he's not going to give you something else. And his work will get done with or without us, believe me. Right? He looks at his roster and he says, all right, they're not ready. Who can I send in? And I don't want us to miss out on the cool stuff, man. If you've never been on the field when God moves, it's amazing. I don't want to be sitting in the bleachers. I want to be right on the field. I want the ball when God's going to move. Right? And that's what I want for all of us. So we as a team here love you. And we say the same things over and over and over 100 different ways so that maybe it'll sink in, because that's how I have to hear it. I'm a moron, right? So I have to hear it that way and say it that way and remind myself constantly what I'm supposed to be about. And that's why I'm careful who I spend time with. I'm careful what music I listen to. I'm careful what movies I watch, because I don't want anything to interfere or cloud that for me. You know, I'm as serious as a heart attack when it comes to salvation, because I know that in a blink of a moment, I've seen, we had a young lady sitting there, and 3 days later, she was dead in Key West. We don't know when our time's going to come. And the time that we have now, we want to use it for good, and we want to make an impact on the people God's put in our lives. And I know your hearts. I've seen you guys. There's nothing you won't do to help somebody. I've seen you raise funds and work hard and build things and just use your talents in so many different ways because you have hearts filled with love. But sometimes you need a kick in the butt. I'm your kick in the butt. Praise God. Because we love you, and that's why we'll kick you. In Jesus' name, be kicked. And get on with it, because you know what? There's so much more to do. But there's so many people that just need Jesus, especially now. My God, did you ever think that a year ago that a 12-pack of toilet paper would be like a score? You know, it's like, holy crap, I got a 12-pack. Because our life got turned upside down. It got all crazy. And it's still crazy out there. And people are isolated and in trouble financially. And their families separated, and they can't get here, and they can't go there, and they can't visit, and they can't touch, and they're afraid. They're afraid because they don't know what's next. This has been nuts, but what's next? They're afraid because they don't have the trust that we have. See, I don't care who's in the White House. I follow politics a little, and I got a choice, but I'm not going to kill myself if they don't win. I don't care. See, as long as Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of God the Father, I'm okay. I'm good. My blessings don't come from Washington. My blessings come from the throne room of God. And I'll always be okay as long as that stays, and he's the same today, yesterday, and forever. So I'm pretty good, right? I'm going to be okay, and so will you. So let that stuff go. And get on with what we're supposed to be getting on. We are here to build the kingdom of God here in the hearts of men and women. Not some other crap. Leave that for the knuckleheads on the news. Right? Let's be about what we're supposed to be about. Let's be grown-ups. Let's be fully mature Christians that truly love. Because if you love somebody, then you'll do something about it. Amen? I love you. Please take that as it was meant and intended. But you know what? Chew on that this week and say, man, have I been doing what I'm supposed to do? Have I shared Christ with my sister? Have I shared Jesus with my mom or my aunt who's maybe closer to heaven than I am, right? But we never know. But have I done what I should do? Because I really want to be with them forever. And I want to be with you guys forever. And Jace, who sang about, let my mansion be by the throne, right? I'm just happy if mine is not right next to Mike. Because he'll be screaming at me, get off my lawn. Love y'all. Here's Yousef to close us out.
Powerful stuff. Give Bill a hand, everybody. That was powerful stuff. I know I needed to hear that. It's what we're compelled to do in Scripture, right? Go out into the highways and bring them into the Lord's house. Amen. I know I can only speak from personal experience, but I was trying not to cry the whole time because I'm hearing about Lazarus. Y'all know I'm emotional, but I'm hearing about Lazarus, you know, being in heaven and looking down. And you know, my dad was a Muslim till the day he died. Stand it on that principle. And before he died, I got to sit down with him, and I hadn't seen him in a couple years. And I just, you know, Dad, I'm a Christian. I believe Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins, and I believe I'm going to heaven when I die. My dad sat there for a minute, and he went, there's a book of Yeshua in the Quran. It's written about him. And I'm like, then why can't you acknowledge him as the Son of God? Unfortunately, some of us men are built too stubborn, am I right? I know I was at a long time in my life. But unfortunately, now I'm going to be Lazarus in heaven looking down on torment, and that kills me a little bit. But the one benefit I have and the one blessing I have is my mother's sitting right over there. That my daughter, she may not be here today because my wife is 9 months pregnant with another daughter, and my house knows the Lord, and that's what we're supposed to do. It starts with us starting with our family, and then we spread it on out, amen? That's what we're supposed to do. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and all of this shall be added unto you. So if you haven't accepted that change in your life, I can't drag you and make you do it. I can only tell you that when I made the decision to seek Christ and put him first in my life, that was when things finally got good. That was when joy finally found its way into my life, and I'll never change that. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If you're feeling compelled to do it, please do it. And let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Repeat after me. Dear God, oh, I know I don't have all the answers, but I know you do. So from this point on, I want to rely on you. By accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So please forgive me. Make all things new. And by the power of your grace, I will now seek to follow you and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you said that prayer for the first time, please let the people know when you're walking out the door, and welcome to the kingdom of heaven. If you truly meant that, I tell you what, the angels are singing in heaven right now if it's happening. So before we leave, I'm going to say a prayer for our departure. So let's go to the Lord in prayer one more time. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this church, for this service, and for this message. And I ask you right now to send forth the Holy Spirit to give us all the strength to spread the gospel. Even in situations where it's uncomfortable and fearful, we need to know and be grounded in the fact that you are there, and you will give us the words, and you will multiply. And we ask you to just help us be humble servants, to seek and serve you, and to be guided by you and your word. I thank you for this family. May it grow and multiply. And be with us as we go on out on our ways. Protect us. Put your angels around us and guide us. And thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen. We good? All right, I had to cut the live feed real quick because we're doing something. So,